So when you get that pill in your hand, it's and you have it in your pocket or in your hand, and you know, you're like, wow, you know that you're gonna get high. You scrape the coating off, you can chop it up into a line. You have your little rituals. You know, when I first started doing it, I had my ritual. I'd wait till I get home, put on some music, pull out the little glass table that I had around the couch, and I'd sit there with my lighter, with a dollar bill, with a card. You know, you crush it up, you cut it up, you line it up, you got the music going. And it's got this distinct taste to it too when you snort it. And you start to crave that taste. And as soon as you hit that line, it's like just you sit back, and 5 minutes later, all pain, stress just starts to leave your body, and you start to kind of sink into the couch and just get numb. Whatever you're dealing with just goes away. Then we started smoking it. You take the coating off, you put it on a piece of foil. And then you hit that smoke. And as soon as that smoke comes into your lungs, you hold it in as long as you can, and you breathe out, and within minutes, you're high. I was a good kid. I was mischievous, but I was good-hearted. I had a good heart. Yeah, I heard a lot, you know, you're a good kid, you have a good head on your shoulders, or, you know, that I had a big heart, because I would, you know, when I was a kid, I'd get bummed and sad when I'd see, like, a homeless person, you know, a stray dog. You know, I just had a heart for, I had compassion for people and just life. But I was thrill-seeker. I like to push the boundaries a little bit. I was the one that would try something first and ask for forgiveness rather than permission to do something. I had a lot of insight and perspective when I was a kid, just on people and life, and just kind of really, you know, was on level with just, you know, where things were at. So I was really observant, analytical, thought things through, plans would just kind of develop in my head. A lot of times I'd have ulterior motives for things, and I was a good kid. I lived in the Issaquah Plateau. It was like Pleasantville, high middle to upper class, great views, coffee shop on the corner, smell of fresh cut grass, kids laughing, barbecues, and golden retriever neighborhood. I was an analyst. I was a fraud analyst for a major wireless company up in the Northwest. I would take phone calls, troubleshoot, and deal with identity theft and try and catch identity thieves that are stealing social security numbers. I worked at that for a while, and I wasn't using that. So the boss that I was under would rant and rave about me all the time. They would see in my performance like, wow, this kid's always here. He's always got a good attitude, strong social skills. But I worked really, really hard to get into that back door. And they hired me on. I remember one of the managers saying, you know, there's times where you hire people and you have to give yourself a pat on the back, and that's what we think about you. You know, one would look at me and be like, wow, you really got it going on. I have a good car. I live in a townhouse. I have a lot of friends. I was just loving life. I'm like, yeah, you know, it's like, okay, the job's demanding, but I can handle it. I was really good at being bad. I took pride in the fact that I could drink a ton. I could do drugs in the bathrooms. The whole situation gave me confidence and swagger. I didn't think I could get caught up by anything. I could talk my way out of anything. Actually, you know what? The first time I tried it, I was at a friend's apartment, and it was a friend who had a prescription for it because he had MS. And I started out eating them, like I'd swallow them, you know, just how they were supposed to. And then I started chewing them. At that point, I wanted more. If I had to eat pills, I wouldn't eat pills. I wouldn't look at it as worth it unless I was drinking and smoking weed with that. And my friends were like, this hits you within 5 or 10 minutes. And so I knew it was gonna be a faster high.
What I've learned in this generation, a lot of kids, everybody's a victim of something. Dude, the lost generation is past. I think we were lost. I think the generation before that was lost. Now, it's the I don't give a F generation. You know what I mean? These kids are like, dude, I don't live for nothing. I don't love anything. I don't care about you. I don't care about me. What's right, what's wrong? It's like, I'll figure it out when I'm there. And growing up, there was always a line and a boundary of, you know, good, evil, right and wrong. So, you know, as kids, you want to step those. Sometimes you just, it's human nature as a youth to cross that line. Now I realize, being like me, I'm a knucklehead, and we go through stuff, and you have people that tell you, you don't do it, it's not good for you. It's like, okay, cool, I'll figure that myself. And then sometimes if you're like me and you're like other people, you just, no matter what people tell you, you're just gonna have to experience it for yourself.
White little piece of gold you have in your hand, and you look at it, and it says OC on one side, 80 on the other, and you just, just holding it in your hand, it makes you feel like you're gonna be okay. Like, okay, this is gonna be okay.
I was a professional drug and alcoholic. I was doing it so long that if I was partying on coke all night, from feeling like you're gonna come apart at the seams, you have to pop some Xanax to just smooth things out. So when you wake up, you're like, you think you're level-headed, but you're totally whacked out. But you're more level-headed than like some crazy cokehead, you know, all edgy in the morning. From the outside, it's like I look like I had it all together. You know, all my friends were like, oh man, you know, that's cool. You could party, man. Like they tell me you can party because you got your job and you're traveling the world and you're doing it big and, you know, it's cool. But on the inside, I was like, dude, I don't want to do this anymore. I'm like, I'm not happy when I do it. And I just do it because I'm a creature of habit. And all my friends do it. And not because of my friends, don't get me wrong. I look forward into getting high and partying.
It's like when you're on it, there's everything else. And then there's Oxy, relationships, talking to people. Food, you don't eat, you don't really care about food. Sex, I knew a bunch of couples that were in it, good friends of mine, where they would never even touch each other anymore. Everything takes a backseat to this drug because it feels so good, and then it gets to a point where you need that feeling to even function. So for a long time, I did okay. But when you wake up, you don't have a pill, don't have any drugs, it's automatically a horrible day. And your mind starts plotting and scheming of how, when, what you're gonna do, who you're gonna screw over, who you're gonna steal from, what you're gonna pawn, who you're not gonna pay back that day. There's so many times where I'd get screwed over from people I've known for 10 years. Okay, well, it's either get high or pay Alex back. And there's no question. Every line, every boundary, every moral standing that you have will eventually succumb to this darkness.
Before it was, you know, try this here, a little innocent here, and now it's just like all or nothing. I think today with, you know, with music, with Hollywood, everything that we see on TV, just the direction that the world is gone, there are no more boundaries. So these kids are open to absolutely everything that this world throws at them. I mean, because it's either glamorized or it's like, there are a lot of kids that are in pain. It's like, yo, if this makes me feel better, I'm gonna do it.
I got called into the office by my supervisor. So I knew automatically, okay, this isn't good. They sit me down at the end of the table. And I remember she looked at me and she looked really nervous and scared, and she looked at me and her face was red. She's like, we have to let you go. And I had just snorted a bunch of Klonopin like an hour before that. So I was tranquilized. I was kind of like, well, okay, I'm gonna go home now. It's almost like I wasn't fathoming what was happening. And I get home, I open the door, it's weird. I'm home at 9:30 in the morning. I'm supposed to be at work. It's that weird feeling like when you play hooky from school. Everything just kind of flooded in. And I just freaked. The next couple days, it was like I had Tourette's. I would just have outbursts because it would hit me. Like, wow, I've been at this place for 5 years, and now I'm not there anymore, and it's because of Oxy. What happened to me? I was this kid with a lot of promise, smart, opportunity was there, charismatic, confidence. All of that was just stripped down to a shell of what I used to be.
You party on drugs, you've seen evil and you've seen good. Like, you know there's darkness that runs with drugs. Okay, that's the bottom line. Like, any drugs you've used, any hard stuff, you'll run into an evil presence sooner or later.
So I'm laying on the couch at my house, TV's on, I think it's on static just because I just don't even want to change the channel. And I'm sick and I'm withdrawing. And it's because I've tapped every resource I have, I need more money, been let go from my job, burnt some bridges. I was at the point where I didn't even have the means to use. I wanted to, and I would have in a heartbeat if I had it, but I didn't have any means to get any drugs, so I started to withdraw. The last week or so I spent in the world of darkness and addiction, I was having the same dream every night. I was on the train sitting down at a table. It was going very fast. It was dark and smoky in the train cabin. Every night I would be sitting at this table with money in front of me. Much like how I'd be sitting at a person's house waiting for the dope man. Every night I would see different faces, friends and acquaintances that I did or currently use Oxy with. I would sit there and wait while the others would quietly wait as well. Some sitting at the table across from me, some in the corner, people sitting or laying on the floor, everyone rocking back and forth from the train moving swiftly across the tracks. The view was always through my own eyes. No one ever made eye contact with myself or others in the cabin. 4 or 5 nights I had this dream, and I wake up feeling despair and no hope in thinking about Oxy. The night before I hit my absolute lowest breaking point, I was having the same dream, sitting at the table, looking around the dark, smoky cabin as it shakes slightly back and forth, and something happened. I looked down at the table, had the money in front of me, and blinked. When I opened my eyes, something inside me said, "Go, get off the train now." I was filled with a sense of urgency. I quickly grabbed the money off the table in front of me. And as soon as I grabbed the money, all the familiar faces suddenly looked at me and made eye contact. The eyes were wide and the expressions were blank and empty, almost like shells of what used to be my friends. I started moving towards the door and everyone is coming at me with their hands out, reaching for me, grabbing me, tearing my clothes as I now desperately tried to get to the now open door. The crowd moves by furiously outside as I could feel the hands grabbing me and tearing my clothes. I jump. I look up to see the train. The train is on fire. As I see the smoke billowing the train disappear into the horizon, I awake. For the first time, I am hopeful. That day, I surrendered my being to God and felt the start of the love and grace that He continues to pour on me today. I have not used Oxy since that day. When I woke up that morning, there was something inside me that was like, okay, now the battle begins. And that feeling inside me was hope. I've always had a heart for God, and I've always known the truth. I was raised in a Christian household, but there's a difference in walking with God and completely surrendering your entire being to serving God and just living for Him. There was something inside me that was like, okay, now it's obtainable. It's gonna be a difficult battle. It's gonna hurt. It's gonna be extremely hard, but it's, you can do this. And I'm about 60 days clean, and I was standing out on Alaskan Way right by the waterfront in Seattle, and I was standing next to my dad. We were talking really bluntly about everything. You know, I asked him, I was like, what's your professional medical opinion on this product? And that's when he told me, I would never prescribe that drug to someone who's not terminally ill. And I was just like, whoa. Fight or flight, Alex. You need to completely remove yourself from the situation. And right then and there is when I made that final jump that I knew was going to change everything, and I was like, okay, I'm moving to California. I'd moved around a lot when I was a kid. Washington is the longest I'd lived in one place ever, and I just had to completely remove myself from the people in the situation. One of the greatest times I had was the trip driving down to California. Got my sunglasses on, music going, I'm with Chris, you know, a friend from third grade. Sun comes up and it hits the hills, and you know, it was gorgeous. I'm like, man, it's just beautiful. I was just so content with being in the moment of where I was at.
You know, we all have some level or some degree that we are victims, but are we gonna live our lives constantly reminded on the fact, well, I'm a victim of this, I'm a victim of that. And that's my excuse for not taking that step forward, or that's my excuse for not trying to get better or succeed, or just live your life to the fullest.
In the first month I was here, I was like, I just felt like I was supposed to go back, like I was just on vacation. Chris had been going to this church for 2 years, and he was like, yeah, I like it, it's cool. So we went Sunday morning, and I was like, yeah, I like this church. You know, it was a pretty big church, a lot of people. I like this, you know, the pastor Ed Ray, he's, you know, a good speaker. Chris is looking over the program from the Sunday service that we just got. He's like, there's a service tonight. This guy, Greg Opean. Normally I'd be like, you know what? I went to church on Sunday. I don't really want to go. But something inside me was like, yeah, you know, check it out. And then this guy comes out on stage and he looked young. And he starts talking, and he's talking like, bro, he's total California surfer guy.
There's an epidemic of young people that are hooked on heroin and Oxycontin. It's a prescription painkiller, and it's destroying lives. Kids are dying from this stuff.
Just the way he was talking kind of captivated me. He was speaking the real. His whole sermon was about taking steps in faith, then he didn't know what God had planned for him, and how he was 25 years old, and how he was sleeping on somebody's floor. It took him a decade to look back and say, oh, that's why I slept on somebody's floor. That's why I went through this. And that just shook me. I got goosebumps right away. I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm 25. I'm sleeping on somebody's floor.
It's like, it's this monster out there that's got its claws into this generation. And I began to pray and say, God, and I had this idea, like, you know, I'm dreaming, like, we need to get, like, and make a documentary, and then you wait. You know, I'm looking for people, and every kid that came in, I was, you know, and I get some kids come in and say, I've been off of it, you know, and I'm like looking at them like, are you the one?
And I was just coming to the facts and, okay, well, what am I doing in California? Why did I fall through that addiction? What's my purpose?
A couple months ago, two guys, I noticed them over here, two new guys in town from Seattle, meet them and hey, let's get together for lunch.
We ended up having lunch for like 2 hours, and we start talking.
Alex has gone through that hell. He's come down to get away from that world that he was in. all of a sudden God brings another piece to the puzzle. There's going to be a documentary. Alex is flying up with Michael and some other of the staff to Seattle, and they're going to interview some people that are still strung out. God is doing something.
I remember I was talking to Pastor Ed Ray about all of this and everything, go back to Seattle with him. He's like, how do you feel right now? And I was like, honestly, I'm scared, nervous, freaked out. He's like, good. That's a good place to be.
I see the Lion's Den.
Lion's Den.
We're going to Seattle.
Weird to be back here. Here's where I ended up on June 28th when I was just like, all right, I surrender, and just kind of just gave up. Just was like, I'm done with this life, and I had to get out of it. So it was pretty amazing time for me because I really kind of got to see how blessed I was with the family and friends that I had that were supporting me through probably the roughest time in my life.
It really wasn't until a number of years later that he opened up fully and shared with me that he, in fact, had been using OxyContin.
So from that day on, I've been clean, but the month or two following that was complete hell and withdrawals.
I can still remember the night that he called me aside, quiet. It was dark outside. We went outside and he said, Mom, I'm so ashamed. And he said, I thought I could control it. I've got friends who've been using this, but I'm hooked on Oxy. My heart just sank when I heard about it because it is so hard to get off of.
This was where my road to a whole different path started. My friend Jeff Olson, I've known this guy since Sunday school. We were both, I knew him before either of us fell into anything. You know, we went to Sunday school together. And I remember getting a call one day before I started using Oxy from another mutual friend of ours. And she's like, Jeff went to rehab. His mom just took him to rehab today. He's been using. Me and his sister went to go see him. And we went into his apartment. And he was just super irritable. And he was mad. And he was yelling. And then he went into his bedroom for like a few minutes and he came out and he was all happy. And I was like, oh man, he's doing drugs for sure.
I thought I had everything together and I thought I had it figured out. I had tons of money. I had a great college life, good friends, nice girlfriend. The funny thing is, I mean, I never would have ever considered myself to be a drug dealer, and that's exactly what I ended up becoming. I just would do pretty much, I guess they call it speedballs all day. I'd do coke and then do oxy, then do coke and oxy, and I didn't even bother smoking pot anymore or anything else like that. I remember on binges I'd have to force myself to try and eat something because otherwise I'd feel like I was going to pass out. I actually had some phone calls from my friends and I denied everything, you know, and I got very defensive with them. You know, I was making about $500 a day and spending probably a lot more than that just to pursue my habit. Even just probably in the couple years that I've used Oxy, lots of people, I think they throw out kind of absurd numbers, but I've probably well overspent over $100,000 just for my habit. I ended up having to sell my car, and I used all the money to buy Oxy. That went out. I maxed out all my credit cards and just did cash advances to use that. And then my girlfriend ended up breaking up with me, which I didn't understand at the time because I thought everything was okay. It's, you know, really hopeful too once you do start to get out of it and you kind of start to see, you know, doors start opening up in your life and good things start happening.
We get to this huge furniture warehouse and I walk in and it's massive. I'm looking around like, man, this is huge. He's really got this put together.
Right now, I've been married for almost 3 months now to my wife, Stevie. And We started a business together about a year and a half ago, and then we actually are closing today on our house too. So we have lots of things going for us. We have a dog, and you know, things are just really good in our lives.
Knowing him from Sunday school, hearing what he's gone through, and then seeing him that day, it was encouraging. It was even encouraging to me because at that time I was only 4 or 5 months clean.
There's a lot of times where, you know, things get tough and you just want to, you know, kind of throw the towel in and just say, I don't care anymore, and go back to it. But it's there's so much more to life than just being a slave to whatever drug you're in. The biggest thing is OxyContin is not a pill, it's heroin. It is heroin. So many people will do Oxy because it's a pill and they make it and it's legal for, you know, people who have terminal cancer and are gonna die.
Jill is a high school friend that I love dearly as a sister. Smart, beautiful, talented. She's the type of girl you look at her and like, yeah, she's, whatever she's gonna set out to do, she's gonna accomplish. One of the head cheerleaders and in school, and just, you know, everyone liked her. Just really just sweetheart. And I watched her do things that she told me she was never gonna do. Multiple times. It was hard, but again, who am I to say anything? I'm right there next to her doing it too.
It's good to see you.
I know. I miss you so much.
Oh, I miss you too. How are you?
I'm okay.
Just okay?
Yeah. I have my days.
She almost starts crying right when she sees me, just because it's like we already both know things are not good.
It's the thing, it's like when you're in high school, you're 18, 19, your biggest concern is, what am I gonna do this weekend?
Yeah. Exactly.
Now it's like our concerns are, who's next? Who's gonna die next?
And think about we left high school with things we were gonna do and things to dream.
Exactly.
You leave
with the biggest ambitions and hopes and just like you wanna conquer the world. And now it's like all people around here are trying to do is just stay alive.
Yeah.
Luck will run out, and it does run out. And I'm kind of finding that out here. When Chris had died, I never thought that someone that close to me would go because of this disease.
Out of everything in her entire room, all I saw were these triggers. And the first thing I noticed is that just the heavy smell of smoked oxy, razor on the table with white powder. I look over to the left and I see a pop can used to smoke weed, you know, how they make it into a pipe, pill bottle. Foil crinkled up, hiding under the bed.
It's really weird because you don't, after so long when you're so tolerant, you really don't get that high, but for some reason, just the motions of it, just buying it, putting it on the foil, lighting it up, the taste of it, holding it in, all of that becomes part of your addiction. It's not just the high. Just recently, a week ago, my best friend died from an overdose, and really that was a huge wake-up call for me. I never thought that anybody so close would be affected. You know, oh, it'll be somebody I hardly know or whatever. And still, even after he died, I still have used, and I just ask myself, why did he die, and why can't I learn?
It was difficult to watch this bright, innovative, thinking, sweet girl go into a scheming drug user.
Because there's only three places that you're gonna end up when you're using, when you're addicted. You're gonna be dead, you're gonna be in jail, or you're gonna be in an institution. There's no other options. You're not gonna have a good life.
But it's almost like she's talking about somebody else when she talks about it. And so it's like the whole time we're doing the interview and she's talking about her friend who just died and how she wants to get out of this life so bad, and you know, it only leads to death and prison and institution.
I hope to have a normal, good life with money and a nice car and a nice house and a good career and help people.
In my head, I'm like, well, why are you still doing it? You know,
Why?
Nothing good has come out of that drug. Nothing good, nothing. I can't even think of one thing. There's just nothing. Everything that's happened is bad.
You know, it seems the biggest catalyst for someone who wants to get clean is just a bottom that they don't want to continue. The unfortunate thing is some people's bottoms are death.
I remember sitting in the back seat of my friend Chris Juergens' 5.0 on the way up here because a friend just died, and now he's buried up here just last week. At the age 25, I shouldn't be able to visit so many people around my age or younger in a cemetery.
And justify till the day I die.
SeaTac Airport in Seattle, getting ready to head back to SoCal.
How are you feeling right now?
I mean, I'm all right, but I don't know. I feel like we did some good down here, and I got to see Jill, and that was cool, and kind of connect with Jeff, but I just feel like I'm leaving Jill with a loaded gun, but there really isn't a whole lot I can do about it. So I'm a little conflicted, but it's like, you know, what am I supposed to do?
I truly, truly do believe that, you know, if you're real and you open up your heart to God, He'll start to take those things away from you.
I'm so unworthy of any of this. It blows my mind. And when I think about it, I'm like, okay, I can't do this. I don't belong here. Even though God has saved me from these pits of hell, it's like, who am I? Who am I to tell these kids or these people anything? So me speaking, no, I don't, that's... I don't even know. I wouldn't even know what to say.
You know, when I came to the Lord, God never, it wasn't all the no's in my life. It was all the yes's in my life. And when I gave my life to God, you know, it was when God said, yo, I don't want you to do this, or let me take away this, or let me add this. And once God started to show me, or God started to tell me no, it was because I knew it was out of love. And it was like a daddy to a son saying, dude, no, I don't want you to do this. I have better for you.
All I want to do is just spread the love and grace that I'm being shown every single day. And that's all I want to do. I just want to run, tell everyone what God's done for me in my life. And just if you surrender and submit to God, what He's going to do in your life, it's amazing.
So, just a little bit of follow-up on the film. Jill's been clean for 4 months now. Jeff is still clean, he's still going strong, but I mean, that's why we're doing this. This is an epidemic, and the reason that this documentary is so important and so crucial is because this is a demon that nobody's talking about. And it's in your home, it's in your schools, maybe even in your pocket. But because it's a pill that doctors make, people think that it's okay to use. This last week, we've been blasting schools with a preview and going in and speaking, me and Greg, and the open doors that we've had have just been astounding. We haven't shown them any paperwork, we haven't shown them any previews of anything, and they're putting us in front of 600 kids to speak. It's such a problem that we tell them we're doing an Oxycontin addiction documentary on just the perils of it, and they're just like, please, come in, speak to these kids. Yesterday, I was at Citrus Valley in front of 600 freshmen, 15-year-old kids, and I asked them, how many of you are directly related or know about Oxycontin? 70% raised their hand. These are 15-year-olds. And in the documentary, I'm speaking about when I'm in the cemetery about how it's taken me all this time to go around to the people that have died from this. And a week before we went and shot Jill, when she's talking to you on screen right there, a week before that is when Chris died. Just a week before that. And this, there's a lot of guilt and shame that comes along with this kind of use, not only with the users, but with the parents. You know, and it's done. There's no more time to play with kid gloves. There's no more time to look for other alternatives to this. We need to tell it for what it is, and that it is a demon, and that it needs to be fought, and it needs to be fought hard. We're not going to tie you to a bed for 90 days until you get clean and send you out into the world until you just abstain, until this demon just gets you again. We want to help you. We're here for you. 9 out of 10 kids who try this stuff, secular statistics, 9 out of 10 kids who even touch this stuff are doomed. Imminent relapse, even if they go to rehab, if they go to detox, anything, 9 out of 10 of these kids are done. Well, guess what? There's a flip side. That's the secular statistics. The spiritual statistics for U-turn for Christ, for people who surrender their life to God, 9 out of 10 kids stay clean. You see a pattern here? I see a pattern. And the pattern is that there's one way out from any kind of darkness and addiction, and that's God. Yeah. Only Christ can take those things out of your life. Like Sonny was saying, when you start to completely just turn your heart to God and say, just use me, I need you in my life, I can't drive this car anymore, I'm gonna crash it. He comes and he hooks you up, he gets your back. And that's what's so important. All these kids, you can go to rehab 5 times in 2 years. Your parents can spend $100,000 on sending you through all these programs, and it doesn't mean jack. It doesn't mean anything. But when you ask God to come in your life and you turn your heart to him, I mean, look at me. I'm just some bloke he pulled out of the dark, and he decided to use me. If he can use me, he can use anyone. He can use any one of you to do anything. Nothing is impossible with God. All things through man do not sustain. Only through Christ in man do things sustain. And you know what? I'm rolling with Christ now. That's who I roll with. Christ, the whosoever's. And what we're trying to do is just rip this whole thing out of the shadows. This is just the breaking off point. I've already been speaking with Ryan and Travis, and they're down. We're going up to the Northwest. We're going back to where we filmed this. And we're going to do a premiere, we're going to do a concert, and we're going to save these kids. We're going to show them that there is hope, there is a way, but there's only one way, and that's through Christ. So please, please keep this in prayer. Keep Jill in prayer. I have countless friends that are just still in these depths of hell, and that's what it is. Addiction, all types of addiction, don't veer too far from each other. It's all a pit. It can all destroy you and make you oblivious to what you're doing to those around you and destroying your own life. And that's why it's so important. So I just want to thank you guys for coming out. And I want to thank everyone involved in this documentary. And first and foremost and completely, I just want to thank God for just putting me here in front of you today, because without Christ, I would be dead right now. So I think we're going to have a little break after this, but again, this is important. Pray for it. Soon there will be copies of this available, and we're going to run tell everybody. We're already getting asked to come back to schools where they want to pack the auditorium so we can speak to these kids. So keep it in prayer, and thanks again for coming out and watching this film.
If you or anyone you know is struggling with prescription drug abuse or any addiction for that matter, there is hope. There is freedom from it. We care, and there's people that care and that can help you. Contact us. We can put you in touch with the right people and the right organizations that can help you get free and clear of whatever you're dealing with. So get at us. God loves you. Peace.